All right. Hi, everyone. I'm Josipa Petinj, the president and CEO of CUTRIC, and I think you will have just been introduced to my colleague, Sama Babsar. We're going to get started. I think we've got most folks having logged in now. And with that, we have quite a lot of information to move through in a short period of time. So let's get started. I'm also going to introduce, just as we kick off, my colleague, Jessica Hansen, who is joining us as well. And Jessica is going to appear there. There she is. And she and Sama are helping to lead the launch of the CUTZEB Joint Procurement Initiative. Jessica is going to be the face of the CUTZEB initiative for our clients going forward into the year, but you'll get to know a lot more about both of these two individuals as they help us to lead Canada's only and first national joint procurement initiative for electric buses and eventually fuel cell electric buses. So just to start off, we're going to ask you just to recognize the consent element that this webinar is going to be an open event available to CUTRIC members and non-members. It will be posted on our website, our YouTube channel, and in other social media platforms to fully inform the Canadian marketplace and transit industry. And by joining this webinar, you are consenting to the recording of the webinar, including any messages that you as a participant may share with CUTRIC and the webinar audience during the course of the event. And this allows us to record it, share it, distribute it, and then field queries as we go forward. So with that, we'll get started. We've got several folks on the line, a number of transit agencies and manufacturers joining us today. In terms of the agenda of what we're going to be reviewing in the next 55 minutes, we're going to walk you through an overview of the CUTRIC Zero Emissions Bus Joint Procurement Initiative. We'll walk you through the board of directors that's been set up to govern the organization. We'll walk you through the round one clientele. We'll walk you through the project plan and outline, and then we'll walk you through some of the feedback and we'll open it up to the feedback that we may receive from folks on the line here today. So with that, we'll move forward to the next slide. And just by way of intro, I already introduced Soumya, but first over to you, Soumya, if you want to just introduce yourself one more time, and then Jessica will turn to you and Michelle Davies.
Sure. Thank you, Josipa. So hello, everyone. My name is Soumya Balsar. I primarily lead the fuel cell bus project at CUTRIC, and I also very actively support the CUTZEB Joint Procurement Initiative at CUTRIC alongside Jessica. I'm based out of Calgary, and I've been with CUTRIC for the last year and a half. I look forward to engaging further with you should you have any questions, concerns, comments after this session as well. We look forward to discussing more.
Thanks so much, Soumya. And next we'll turn to Jessica.
Hello, my name is Jessica Hansen. I'm the project manager for ZEB Initiatives at CUTRIC. I've recently joined the team and I'm really looking forward to getting to know all of you and collaborating with you on this upcoming initiative in the coming weeks and months. Thank you.
And Michelle.
Good afternoon, everybody. Michelle Davies. I'm the Chief Operating Officer at CUTRIC, and I work closely with Josipa across the organization.
Thanks so much, Michelle. And with that, we'll get started. And just by way of review, in terms of the folks that we have on the line, we have colleagues from the A2C community in Quebec, Barrie Transit, Bow Valley Regional Transit, Brampton Transit, Calgary Transit, City of Fredericton, City of Mississauga, City of Niagara Falls, City of North Bay, City of Regina, and Saskatoon. Additionally, in terms of our transit agencies, we have Sault Ste. Marie, Selkirk, Welland, Coast Mountain Bus Company out in British Columbia, Kodiak Transpo, Cornwall Transpo. And then we have on our industry side of the equation, Dentons, Equicharge, the EV Society of Canada. We've got also a series of companies from Schunk Carbon Technology, TCS, Talk Group, and looking here, Visionary Advantage and Voyago School Bus. We've got a few academic members on the line, and additionally, we have several more cities and transit agencies also on the line with us from Halifax Transit, Metrolinx, Niagara Regional Transit, Red Deer Transit, TTC, and Edmonton Transit, as well as TransLink, Halton Hills, and hopefully I did not miss anyone. So if I've missed you, we will make sure to capture you in the official minutes going forward. So with that, I'll ask you to move forward. Soumya, we're going to walk through the overview of the CUTZEB Joint Procurement Initiative. Just to walk folks through this first part of the meeting, we're going to walk you through how the initiative initiative was set up, a little bit of the history, and then we're going to turn to a couple of our board directors for the voice of the customer from the board director standpoint in terms of the transit agencies that will help to govern this organization nationally, and also the voice of the customer from the perspective of the clientele of the first round of joint procurement, which is starting off with London Transit and Burlington Transit. So just to walk you through a bit of the history, CUTRIC started discussions around a federal national joint procurement initiative over 3 years ago. But some of you may recall, if you were part of that, it's actually 4 years ago now. I think the pandemic has mushed our brains. It was 2017, 2018, when we started an innovation P3 initiative. And that was on the basis that some kind of joint procurement had to happen to price reduce, to get volumes up, prices down, but most importantly, to get turnkey solutions out the door. Because those agencies that were doing electric buses at that time with us realized that it was really complicated. The standard wasn't published. J3105 was not out there yet. So you didn't have standardized high power charging. It wasn't clear that J1772 and depot charging would work. There wasn't a lot of modeling out there. We were just developing our modeling tools to get out there. There were a lot of unknowns, and it wasn't clear how much real estate would be required, how much infrastructure, et cetera, et cetera. So very quickly, the idea emerged that CUTRIC should lead a group of its transit agencies who were looking to electrify in joint procurements, where it wasn't just about buying the buses and the chargers, but about buying potentially the turnkey solution. The buses, the chargers, the installation, the maintenance, and everything in between that could go wrong, that all being packaged up into a joint procurement of some sort so that there would be a winner, a consortium set of partners, manufacturers, integrators, maintainers, construction company that could deliver it all as a consortium. But when we started this discussion, there was no zero emissions transit fund federally. It was actually just after a federal election. There was not even a plan of action at Infrastructure Canada to fund this stuff. We were just starting on our own government lobby process at that time. So that's where this whole thing started. Since that time, of course, our CUTRIC members, many of you on the line, helped us to obtain the $2.75 billion in federal funding for zero emissions buses through the Zero Emissions Transit Fund. And that has taken us out of the P3 dialogue towards a funding financing dialogue with Infrastructure Canada's support. And into that, that transitioned into 2020 at the start of the pandemic into a funded and financed federally supported national joint procurement program. And that's where the CUTZEB initiative took root. So what has happened in the last 2 years, from 2020 to early 2022, we held a series of structured consultations and project planning meetings with a group of about 8 transit agencies that attended regularly and gave us insight into what could work, how would it work, which agencies would be first in line for this, which agencies would go it alone and didn't need this, and which agencies would share their recent learnings and difficulties and challenges and solutions from their own initial procurements into this process to support a round two and a round three. And the idea here was CUTRIC was growing as a nonprofit. So could we spin off a fully independent nonprofit corporation, independent of CUTRIC, independent of our board, a spin-off agency as a nonprofit whose only job is to design and deploy joint procurements for battery electric bus systems and eventually hydrogen fuel cell electric bus systems. So within that, I want to specifically say thank you to London Transit, Burlington Transit, York Region Transit, Grand River Transit, Guelph Transit, Brampton Transit, Toronto Transit Commission, Winnipeg Transit. And we did also have colleagues from Laval joining, OC Transpo, Winnipeg Transit, and a few others who joined in the planning process, but those champion transit agencies were consistently part of the planning process and really helped us to flesh out what could work if we in fact launch this initiative and this organization. We'll go to the next slide. So in terms of where this initiative is, for those of you who have been CUTRIC members for several years, you'll know that CUTRIC only does innovation projects. I mean, that's the only reason we exist, is technology innovation in transit and shared mobility. So for this to work, it has to be an initiative that meets our vision and through our mission, our vision being to make Canada a leader in low carbon smart mobility, especially in transit, and our mission doing it through research, development, and demonstration projects and initiatives. So that means for us to launch this, it has to be supporting something that is still not perfectly at TRL 9 levels. TRL 9 levels are everybody can buy it on their own. There's really no issue. There's no integration needed. There's no innovation, like micro levels. So it has to be somewhere at the TRL 7 to 8 level where we're pushing it to the TRL 9 level. And historically, CUTRIC has focused on TRL 4, 5, and 6. That's where our electric bus demo project with TransLink Brampton and York Region exists. That's where the fuel cell electric bus project with MyWay exists. And the reason that these projects are at the technology readiness level 4, 5, and 6 is because on this scale, which was developed by NASA to describe technology innovation, the fuel cell buses and the electric buses and the chargers in and of themselves were market ready. So TRL 8 and 9. But the system together was not market ready. It hadn't been demonstrated as a functioning, turnkey, fluid, efficient, unproblematic system for transit. So putting that whole technological engineering system together, that put it squarely within the technology readiness level 4, 5, 6, which NASA and several industry stakeholders that have bought into using this scale, as have we at CUTRIC, identify as the landscape of beta, prototype, and demonstration heading into large-scale demonstration. Coming out of demonstrations, once you're at the scale where we are now in Canada, we've done several demos, or we will soon be doing these large demonstrations that are part of permanent transit procurements. They're not small pilots, they're not science experiments, they're part of permanent procurements, but they have a lot of things that could go wrong because the technology is not perfectly demonstrated or proven in a system deployment. Part of where we are now is we're at a scale with electric buses and soon with fuel cell buses in the fueling system, where we can just go to procurement to increase volume, decrease prices, and really refine the market commercialization of all of this stuff. And that is ultimately achieved by doing a joint procurement. So that is where we are right now. And we'll go to the next slide. On this basis, we have launched CUTZEB. And so CUTZEB is really at the scale of pushing this joint procurement system through to a technology readiness level of 9. And this is partially where it also differs from other joint procurements. Right now, there's the Metrolinx joint procurement, the TPI that many folks are familiar with. There's the TTC joint procurement for the electric buses. ATUC has a joint procurement process typically that has very well functioned to procure transit. In those agencies and across those joint procurements, the focus is on a TRL 9 product, which is the bus. Over at CUTZEB, we're looking at the turnkey solution. It's the bus and the charger, the real estate, the civil works, the integration, potentially energy storage, integrated in for a full package deal with the data analytics packaged in as well. So not just the capital asset, but the ongoing multi-year data analytics. And so where CUTZEB differs is these core goals. And I'm just going to ask panelists and speakers, if you don't mind muting yourself when you come online, just we'll minimize background noise. So the goals of the CUTZEB initiative is to set a robust plan for long-term joint procurements that allows mid and small size agencies in particular to band together for technology simplification, complexity reduction, and also volume pricing. And a winner-take-all model that ensures somebody is responsible for solving the problems that may go wrong across the whole system, not just the bus, not just the charger, but everything in between and those assets included. It's intended to set a foundation for efficient execution of future procurement projects. So the goal here is that it's not just a one and done. It is indeed something that can be on repeat. So we've got a round one, and the intention is to go to round two and round three. The next is to standardize specifications. So we worked for many years to get J3105 published by the SAE, that being the Society of Automotive Engineers. And for all of you in transit, where you go to buy electric buses, you will most certainly be buying a standardized charging system now. And part of that standardized charging system, if it's a low power depot charger, is standardized by the auto sector previously. And with our support, the SAE J3105 is what you'll be buying for your standardized overhead chargers. But there's a lot of other stuff in between that also needs standardization, like how close can a high power charger be to a hydrogen fueling tank in a depot? These are the kinds of things that a joint procurement can help us to sort out over the next few years as everybody marches towards zero emissions transit by 2040. So standardizing those specifications, and within that, helping transit agencies understand bigger isn't always better. So making sure that the size of the battery pack and the power level of the charger is not overkill. You're not buying more than you need. You're not paying for more battery pack than you need. You're not paying for higher power chargers than you need because you can't handle them anyhow and you won't use them and you're just going to degrade them and waste that money. So part of this is standardizing the specifications, but also helping agencies buy right, engineer right sizing the products for their procurement needs. Within that, then, of course, number four is managing all those tech and operational risks. And by that, we mean not just the risks with the bus and not just the risks with the charger, but if you're part of our electric bus project, then you know there's a lot of risks in between there. And sometimes the bus or the charger might not work and it's not quite clear, is it the bus or the charger? And whose problem is that to solve? So part of this is making sure that there's a consortium winning bid whose problem it is to solve that so that the transit agency is not stuck on its own with its labor trying to figure out where's the problem and who needs to solve it and picking up the phone and calling five different OEMs to figure out whose job it is to solve some error code that has come up. So the idea here is that the technology and operational risk across the whole system in your procurement is actually managed by a winner of a bid that is a consortium set of partners. And then number five is enabling the suppliers with a long-term supply chain planning process. And this means whether it's the bus manufacturers, the charging manufacturers, or all the systems in between, the civil works optimization folks, the facilities upgrade folks, and also frankly, the utilities in your backyard that are providing the power or the hydrogen supplier, giving them and starting to give them some market signals on joint bases as to what the procurement landscape looks like in Canada in the next 2, 3, 5, 10 years, so they can start to predict how much supply needs to come through the network in this domestic jurisdiction, being Canada. You know, we do live within a globalized world, and we certainly live within a new NAFTA region, and we're not always the first place where manufactured products are going to come off the line and be delivered. So making sure that we're positioning our agencies in a way that we are within the pipeline, or rather on the factory and assembly floor and lined up properly with a bulk procurement that prioritizes agencies who normally wouldn't be prioritized because maybe you're a small agency, you can only buy a few buses at a time, so you're back of the line in the assembly plant. This certainly should help in that regard. So those are five of the core goals. In terms of the benefits, looking at the technical integration of turnkey solutions, this is the clear element here. This is the driving factor, right? The idea that you've got somebody responsible who are technically competent somebodies who are responsible for all the turnkey elements, again, between the chargers and the buses and everything in between. The volume-based pricing, as we mentioned, greater numbers should result in lower prices. The outsourcing of technical competencies and specialist knowledge, where transit agencies are not prepared right now to hire staff internally. Some of you, over the course of a couple rounds of joint procurement, or maybe even one, will eventually hire your own people in-house, but some of you never will and never should, because it's better to outsource it given your size or your corporate structure. So that really depends on your transit agency and your municipality and how many people you want to hire full-time on staff with these knowledge sets. And given the fact there aren't that many people in Canada right now ready to be hired with this expertise knowledge, number three is really about making sure the experts, the few and far between, are actually being matched with the agencies that need them and not making you having to hire them to be able to do that. Number four is ensuring that there's a neutral and transparent governance model. So I think one thing that CUTRIC is known for is a lot of governance. We make sure that our projects are hyper transparent, that there's program steering committees, there are boards, that there's transparency in minute taking, there's transparency in decision making, that motions follow proper methodologies, and that they're fully auditable and open in that regard. And so following those best practices, having a governance model, which allows the taxpayer and the municipality or the regionality involved to know that there is a large amount of democratic transparency involved in how these funds and dollars are being used. That's really quite critical. So that's part of the joint procurement. Number five is ensuring that it's a standalone organization with a standalone board of directors that is comprised of nothing but Canada's top talent in electrification. And we're going to go through some of that top talent today. There are not that many people in Canada in transit that have actually the lived experience of buying or deploying electric buses. Probably I could count on my hands and toes, the people. There's not that many, frankly. And that is simply the reality of where we are in the industry landscape. So take the people who need to buy this stuff and the people who have actually deployed this stuff and you've probably got about 24 people, which is who we've drawn upon to structure our board in the first instance, or they are the people whom we've drawn upon to structure our board at CUTRIC or our clientele within CUTZEB. And then last, enhancing the post-deployment element. We don't do anything without data analytics. I personally don't believe in it, so you're never going to get that out of CUTRIC. It has to be data analyzed, evidence-based decision-making for the future. And this is billions of dollars with no hyperbole intended. It is billions of dollars out the door for really new technologies. We need to make sure that this stuff is working. If it's not working according to the way that the manufacturer said it would work, that those data are transparently available to the client and the manufacturer to fix the problem. And this is critical. Our joint procurement has neutral data analytics led by the CUTRIC team through a nonprofit governance structure baked into the joint procurement. And that is part of the zero emissions transit fund that we worked so hard to obtain in the last few years. Those are some of the benefits. So we'll go to the next slide. That takes you through the modus operandi, that takes you through the background history, that takes you through why we have agencies that advise this, yes, CUTRIC should invest money, launch this independent organization, incorporate it, set up a board, and get it going with a clientele, and that's where we are now. So now I'd like to introduce you to our initial board of directors. It is informal right now until the articles of incorporation are fully filed with Industry Canada, which are in the process right now of being formalized. We reached out to the who's who of expertise who are not conflicted. And that I will put out there very critically. As I said to you, there's only about 24 people who actually have this kind of experience on the ground at a leadership role in transit agencies in Canada. And some of them are conflicted, and they're conflicted because they sit on the CUTRIC board. So primarily they may be out as a result of that, or they may be a clientele, and we're going to introduce the clientele in a moment, or they're so overrun, frankly, as many of you are aware, with electrification in their agencies right now that they're simply not available and there's just not enough of them to go around. So when we take a look at the who's who in the industry who has the leadership experience and the senior decision-making capabilities, combined with the lived experience of actually having developed a plan to procure and deploy electric buses and is living through the dream or the headache sometimes of electrification, then we come to a finite set of folks. And right now, our confirmed board members, as it stands today, September 13th, is Blair Allen, who is joining us here today from Grand River Transit in Waterloo. We have Chris Hill, who is joining us today from Guelph Transit, both in Ontario. We have Eddie Robar, who isn't able to join us today, but he is on our board, and he represents, of course, the Edmonton Transit regional jurisdiction. And we have Ralph Nielsen, who represents us from way out west in TransLink. He's not available here today with us, but he does sit on our board here, and he also sits on our program steering committee for an electric bus project with CUTRIC. So when we take a look at these folks right now, each of their agencies has gone through electrification recently. They have either recently procured vehicles, or they're in their second round of procuring vehicles and charging systems, or they are in the learning round from their first procurement of what they learned, what they got right, what they got wrong, and what they're planning to do ahead. They are not currently clients of CUTZEB. So TransLink, Edmonton Transit, Guelph Transit, and Grand River Transit are not currently clients of the joint procurement in round one. If and when those agencies wanted to enter into round two or round three, they would exit representation from the board to maintain absolute independence of governance. We have also invited Marc-André Varin at ATUC, and many of you are familiar with ATUC. Oodles of experience in joint procurements. It's one of the main business lines at ATUC is joint procurement for the Quebec Transit agencies. They just went through a large joint procurement in Quebec. So there's a lot of knowledge there to share as well. And we are simply awaiting Marc-André's approval to go through the process, and then we'd be bringing him to the board. Now we're gonna turn to a couple of our colleagues. First, Blair, got you on the line from Grand River Trans. I'm going to turn to you, if you wouldn't mind walking folks through here, a little bit of a review as why Grand River Transit was supportive of the initiative and what you're hoping to be able to support in terms of your board role in the joint procurement nationally. And over to you, Blair. We'll see if we can make you live.
Oh, hopefully you can hear me now.
Yes, we can.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Yes, from Grand River Transit's perspective, we started a couple of years ago working with CUTRIC to analyze just where it made sense for us to start with electrification. And as anybody who's looked a bit at this knows, it is, as you saw Josipa's all her details of the, there's a lot of stuff going on and it's all new for everybody. And there's a lot of changes very rapidly going on. And I think by working together with some of the other agencies and with CUTRIC, one of the things that we may have to do is just provide some basically information that can support it and give some confidence to our decision makers, our politicians, and our senior management that what we're embarking on here is a reasonable approach and that we have some confidence that we can make this all work and succeed with it. And by working more jointly, and that gives us that sort of ability to show that we're not doing this on our own. And while we haven't at this point with the just timing for us, we had to get our procurements done, and with the funding that we had in place already to move forward, we couldn't join this version of the joint procurement process itself, but our involvement in it in the background and helping to at least understand where it was going. And we see that by continuing to be involved in it, we hope to, one, provide our input and support and some of the knowledge we're gaining to those who are involved in it, and be able to be a bit of a sounding board so that they make sure that it's the do proceed, that we can be sort of a help check their sort of direction and make sure that the questions are answered correctly and that they can move forward. And we're not saying that we know more than some of the people that are involved that are going to be actually doing the joint procurements right now, but that I think there'll be a bit of back and forth and helping out to make sure that that's done effectively. And for those who are considering moving forward in this, again, that's that joint knowledge, I think, is one of the strongest elements of this. It's going to be valuable in our discussions that we've had in some of the meetings as we led up to the formation of CUTZEB, was quite valuable to even understand the procurements, the what are the values of doing it jointly versus trying to go on your own. What are the key things that you have to actually consider with this when you're not just procuring a new bus? Like many of us all have knowledge of how to procure a bus, but it's a whole ecosystem that you have to build around that bus that's very critical and important to make this work properly.
And if I may, Blair, there's two elements that folks may not be aware of, depending on where they're joining us across Canada today. But certainly GRT is the kind of mid-sized transit agency that a lot of agencies within our membership are. It's about 250 buses, I think 35 special mobility vehicles. So it puts you squarely in that zone of many of the agencies that have come to us and say, look, like, we're not ready to hire 10 people to lead this right away, but we're also not a very small agency of 10 buses, and we're being asked by our city council to move tomorrow. And so it's right in that in between. You know, if you're TTC or TransLink, you might have more resources to hire people to move a division to make things happen, but right in that in between is where we're finding the special need for technical support, certainly in the next 4 to 5 years during this procurement period. So for folks who aren't as familiar with Grand River Transit, that is one of the great values we hope to draw on. The second element is, of course, Grand River Transit has the ION train, and there is a large discussion about the movement towards transit agencies integrating with LRT or train stations for electrification. And that is something that we just don't have a lot of across Canada. We have Calgary, we have Edmonton, we have Ottawa, we have TTC, Montreal, Vancouver, Grand River. You know, there's a handful, basically a couple handfuls of agencies with LRT or train stations, not many. And so even that expert knowledge is finite and limited, and that is a core goal. So thank you so much, Blair. Not sure if there's anything you want to add there, and then we're going to turn to our colleagues from Guelph Transit.
No, I think you spoke to the right things there. And in addition, again, yeah, we're not small, but we're not a huge system. We don't have all the resources in, and like a lot of places, you're constrained by what you can do, and we have to try and fit this new project in with the staffing that we have right now And I think that jointly doing it is going to help that process.
Thanks so much, Blair. And now we're going to turn to Chris Hill, just down the highway and around the corner from Guelph Transit. Chris, over to you if you can help folks understand where Guelph Transit is and why you've become supportive of the CUTZEB initiative.
Yes, thank you, Yosipet. Good afternoon, everybody. Guelph Transit is a small transit agency. We have just 80 40-foot buses and 13 mobility buses in our fleet. So we joined CUTRIC in June of 2019. When we first got started on this project, I'm the manager of fleet planning, and in Guelph, Fleet was given the lead for the procurement of electric buses for Guelph Transit. We also did apply for funding through ICIP, which was announced in January of 2020, and removed some of the financial risk for us, but there's still many risks to be determined through, or sorry, that we've encountered just because of our size and because of our essential lack of knowledge in terms of what's all involved with fleet electrification. And CUTRIC filled that gap admirably by doing the by verifying the performance claims of the electric bus manufacturers. From our and we do have an order in currently right now for four electric buses as well as electric vehicle charging at our transit facility. Both projects, not surprisingly, due to the current supply chain situation, are way behind schedule right now. We'd expected to receive the buses and the charging equipment a couple of months ago. It'll probably be the end of the year before we actually see the vehicles on the ground at our facility and ready to be charged there. So with regards to joint procurement, as we discovered through the learning process, it's a really small market for transit buses in North America. They only sell about 5,000 new vehicles a year. And in Canada, in the electric bus sector, there's four companies that are competing for the 40-foot bus segment that's out there. So it's a maturing market in that area, or a market-ready situation in that area, where actually probably the vendors are ahead of the consumers here in terms of their knowledge and their technical capabilities. So we do need the resources of somebody like CUTRIC, which I think is a unique and quite exciting organization to be associated with. You know, there's nothing like it in the United States, for example, and the level of expertise is just, it's very reassuring to us when we're looking for answers to questions. There's no other organization like it, and we're proud to be associated with CUTRIC. We did go out for procurement solo in 2021. Although we were interested in joint procurement at the time, we found that nobody else was just quite ready at that time. So we are, if you like, we're holding joint procurement as a plan B for us on future procurements as we move through the pilot project phase of our voyage of discovery here and move into deployment of electric buses. We do have a target of acquiring up to 65 electric buses between now and 2027. And some of those may be done through the joint procurement phase. We're keenly interested in helping this process move forward and looking forward to seeing the results.
Thanks so much, Chris. That does give a good context and actually is an excellent segue as to why on the board we looked for large, mid and small size transit agencies. So as I noted, Eddie Robart and Ralph aren't with us today, but TransLink and Edmonton are obviously very large transit agencies and their procurement experience has been quite complicated. So there's a lot to learn from that we're looking to download the knowledge and information from. But over at Guelph, as Chris noted, there's about 80 buses or so. We have a transit agency that's one of our first clients into this system that is in that space. And so as a result, what we'll do now is we'll turn to the next section in the agenda, which is a review of the clients of the first system. And so the clients of the first system there, we'll just put it a large, is Burlington Transit and London Transit. And with that, we're going to turn to our colleagues at London Transit, represented by Kelly Pleshny. You can see here that London has about 200 buses, so squarely in that GRT zone, and that is part of why we wanted that expertise at the board level, looking to go to zero emissions quite aggressively with a really proactive city council and mayor. So helping London get there is going to be really critical for all those agencies that are in that 200 to 300 bus zone. But over at Burlington, and we'll be bringing on live Sue Connor to represent Burlington Transit here today, you can see a smaller agency around 70 buses. That city council also quite proactive, a much smaller agency to work with, fewer people on staff and less opportunity even than London to in-house expertise. So we are seeing more agencies come to us that are at that Burlington size and smaller. We've had a few agencies reach out and they have under 10 buses in their fleet and could they join a joint procurement? That starts to make a lot of logical sense when you're that small in terms of banding together, but you don't have the ability to create that consortium on your own. So let's start first off with the first two clients of the system. And Kelly, we'll turn to you and bring you live here. And over to you, Kelly, if you can help folks understand why London is moving this way in general, and then also why joint procurement of this type.
Sure. Thanks, Josipa. I think, from London's perspective, we've always been supportive of joint procurements. We were one of the founding members of the original Metrolinx joint bus procurement many, 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 many years ago. So we certainly see the value in that for anybody participating. But with respect to this one, I think the biggest consideration that we had was based on the risk transfer, and you covered that well in the, you know, in the initial slides. We certainly stayed in contact with Brampton and York Region through their pilot and through working with CUTRIC, and heard about all of the headaches experienced with, you know, the buses and the chargers not necessarily talking to one another. And quite honestly, we don't have the expertise, obviously, and we don't have the capacity to bring on the staff to try to solve those problems as we move forward. So the turnkey solution was a really, really critical piece for us, especially initially. That may change going forward once we've got, as you said, more experience and we've got staff on board that can help deal with that. We may look at doing something different, but certainly initially we believe that this is, you know, this is the right way, the right path forward for us. And, you know, relying, you've heard from the board members, relying on that expertise of systems that have been there. The other perspective I'll share with London is we've done things the wrong way, and we still, well, I'm one of the few left that still remember it, but I remember when we jumped in very quickly with the first low floor natural gas buses and converted about a third of our fleet over a 3-year period, and ended up retiring all those buses at the 6-year mark because it didn't work and it wasn't well thought out, and, you know, for any number of reasons. So that memory is still here, and, you know, and it's something we don't want to replicate. We want to do this one right. So we just believe that this is the best path forward for us.
Thanks so much, Kelly. And that actually summarizes it really well. I mean, a lot of what we're trying to do here is make sure it's as evidence-based as possible. Obviously, we don't know everything. You know, unfortunately, I'm not a witch. I don't have a crystal ball, can't read the future. Maybe I was in a past life, but who knows? So having said that, we'll get some things wrong for sure, but that's new technologies. And the more that we have the knowledge download, and the more that we do the pre-planning as we've done with London, the more likely we are that the expenditure will actually meet the expectation. And our hope here is, of course, that not only does the expectation meet the expenditure and vice versa, but that through the constant data analysis, there's a constant feedback loop to manufacturers to fix it in real time, because there will be a consortium of partners, not just a bus manufacturer and a charger manufacturer. There will be a consortium of partners whose job it is to fix the problems, capital P and small p. So that's the intention. Now, I will also segue from your comment. We have been asked, but, you know, how many rounds will you do? Well, we're setting up CUTZEB so that we can do potentially like an ongoing permanent set of rounds, potentially becomes an ongoing permanent joint procurement nationally. But I don't envision that it will always be for electric buses. It will eventually be for hydrogen fuel cell buses and green hydrogen, which is proving to be a challenge for agencies to procure on their own. It will eventually be for autonomous electric shuttles and DSRC units and 5G. So eventually, CUTRIC being a nonprofit should work itself out of the industry. There should be a day when transit agencies don't don't need our help for electric buses because we got the TRL 10, but they will need our help for procuring autonomous shuttles or whatever new technology is coming down the pipeline that we're trying to advance. And that's as many rounds as it will last, which is probably ad infinitum. So thank you very much, Kelly, for that insight. I'll just keep you here online in case there's questions for you particularly. I'll turn to Sue from Burlington, a smaller agency, and Sue, with your experience from Brampton, a much larger agency, if you can walk folks through why would a smaller agency be part of a joint procurement like this?
So, yeah, I can, you know, I really, I don't want to repeat anything Kelly said, but it's all really appropriate to us as well. We're even a smaller staff, so we, you know, see the benefit. We have been in the Metrolinx joint procurement, and having gone through the initial launch of the pilot when I was in Brampton, you know, we quickly understood how complicated it was. It wasn't like we were just going out to buy an electric bus and that was it. And, you know, we certainly even then turned to CUTRIC back then to get some advice. So I mean, I think one of the big things I'd like to say is I actually just took a report to our council committee meeting today to get the funding and the permission to join CUTZEB's joint procurement. And I have to say there were no questions on my report, just comments from councillors, and our councillors have been educated on CUTRIC, and they definitely respect the organization and feel confident in the ability for CUTRIC to deliver this promise of electric bus pilot for Burlington. That was very clear in the comments that were made. And as Josipa knows, we did a workshop in Burlington just over 2 years ago, in fact, the month before the pandemic started. And it was really an eye opener for our councillors who just thought it was a simple matter of going out and buying a couple of electric buses. They were really educated, and I think they were really blown away by what CUTRIC brings to the table and the value for a municipality of our size. They're very keen to move forward. And, you know, of course, months before a municipal election, it was a feather in their caps to have that report go today. But we also have a group in Burlington called Burlington Green that came to actually delegate in support of our report. So, you know, it was very positive, definitely very positive for the new director of transit that's taken over for me, two positive reports today. So, yeah, I mean, I'm happy to answer any questions, but I think, you know, Kelly and I had some conversations early on about how we were going to approach this and the pressure we were with our councils in terms of electrifying the fleet, and talked about maybe jointly hiring a consultant. And then we finally came to the conclusion, why don't we just use CUTRIC? And here we are.
Thanks so much, Sue. And I'm glad you came to that conclusion. But having said that, I mean, the reality is CUTRIC's come out of transit needs. So hopefully the feedback cycle is feeding back into transit exactly what you need, because it was created by and for transit. To that point, Sue also raises a really good point. I know we have some folks on the line from very small agencies around the country. If you do have a city council that you think would benefit from like an educational workshop about electric buses and chargers and fuel cell buses, we do that. And we do it for our members for free. So please let us know and our team will go and I'll show up and we'll help educate your counselors so they can ask every question they have before you even start down this pathway. And it will be that much easier, hopefully, through the approval process that follows, that the technological knowledge is there and the understanding is there. So with that, I'm just going to see, Kelly, if there's anything last you'd like to add, or Sue, at this point before we move through and just giving folks a sense of the process ahead.
Nothing else from me.
Thanks so much, Kelly.
Nothing for me either.
Thanks so much, Sue. So thank you again to both of you. For those of you who don't know, Sue was our chair for many years. And so to the extent that CUTRIC is successful in this regard, it's really out of about half a decade of her leadership at the helm of the organization. So thank you to you both. With that, we're going to move to the penultimate item on the agenda and then open it up to questions if there are. So to let folks know and transit agency know, how will this work? How does it function? How is it paid for? So right now, what you've got in front of you is a high level schematic. Essentially, there are the participating transit agencies, and the two clients are Burlington and London for round one right now. If you want to become part of round one, which is taking effect starting in October post incorporation of CUTZEB as an independent nonprofit entity, and will flow through the next fiscal year into the end of 2023 fiscal year, so into 2024, you want to join at that point in this joint procurement. There are potential on-ramps, and we're going to give you the contact at the end of this webinar as to who to connect with so that we can go educate you and bring you in and let you know what the on-ramping possibility is. But in general, round one is launching with Burlington and London. Those agencies have purchased the services for planning, or will be purchasing the services for planning. And that planning work includes everything from development of the request for information to OEMs, to a request for proposal with all the tech specs that will inform the bus composition, the charger composition, and all the work in between the civil works, et cetera. That procurement will include details around where the chargers need to be located and the power level. And that will go out to the marketplace. And the marketplace will self-organize and respond. So bus manufacturers, charging manufacturers, construction companies, civil works will have to form a consortium to respond to all the elements within the proposal, because the proposal will include a number of buses, a number of chargers, depot and en route charging, as well as the civil works, the installation, and the support on the performance in an ongoing fashion for that whole system. That will be in the proposal information, and consortia of partners will be expected to respond. The way it is structured here then is that ultimately CUTZEB is the entity being contracted by the clients. And so Burlington and London Transit will be contracting CUTZEB, which is independent of CUTRIC. As an independent nonprofit, CUTZEB is applying to Infrastructure Canada's Zero Emissions Transit Fund to offset the cost of all of this planning work, including any feasibility or implementation work that may not have been completed. So if there's anything missing from the implementation plans in the A to Z of all the questions that should have been asked prior to going to a capital procurement, if any of that is missing, then CUTZEB will apply to have that covered at 80% cost reduction, as well as the RFI and RFP assessment process, which is part of the procurement planning. That is all intended to be 80% cost recovered through the Zero Emissions Transit Fund federally, which CUTZEB will apply into. CUTZEB will then hire CUTRIC as the federal preferred nonprofit vendor to deliver those procurement and planning assessments and outcomes and deliverables. So the intention here and the setup is that London and Burlington pay about 20% of the cost of all of this work, as it's considered part of it's part of planning and early stage feasibility, implementation, and planning work prior to capital purchases. All of that falls within that Zero Emissions Transit Fund environment and envelope. And as a result, the clients here would only be responsible for 20% of those costs, and the federal government would offset this planning process by 80%. So that is how it is structured. And the reason that it's so important CUTZEB as a nonprofit entity is independent of CUTRIC is, of course, because CUTRIC is the preferred nonprofit supplier of these services, my apologies. And as a result, has to be completely separate from CUTZEB and its board of directors and its governance model. So having said that, the outcome of this joint procurement structure, if we go forward, will be a winner-take-all model. And that means that if I walk you through just high level, we've got the onboarding process right now in terms of onboarding the board of directors, finalizing the incorporation, setting up the governance, the bank account, all of the accoutrements of a fully independent nonprofit. It then moves through the finalization of the round one specifications for the two clients, Burlington and London. Those specifications, which will be informed by an RFI, will go out through a proposal process. The intention is that that proposal should get out by the end of the year at the latest, at the beginning of next year and into next year. That proposal process should be completed by the end of Q2 next year, with bid evaluations taking effect. that winner take all model, which will include the buses, the chargers, and everything in between, plus the data analytics, will go to an approval by the end of Q3 in 2023. And at that point, the two clients of round one, Burlington and London, will have a winner of that entire process with a price point for the buses, the chargers, and everything in between that they require. And with that, those agencies will go to obtain zero emissions transit funding at 50% cost offset through the capital funding process at the federal level. So that's how the structure has been set up over the last year and a half and is now being formalized through a corporation named CUTZEB. If we go to the next slide, just to walk you through some of the final elements. Actually, we can go back one slide. Sorry about that, Soumya. That is just a heads up about our conference. But that walks you through the final elements there in terms of the readiness and the quarters and the activities that will unfold. We do say it's the intended project plan because this is the first time it's ever been done in Canada that such a national joint procurement can occur. And it's the first time that such a structure has been created to enable any agency across Canada from Saskatoon to BC Transit to Halifax Transit, up in St. John's, over in Kodiak, and way up to Quebec City. If all those agencies wanted to join hands and engage in a joint procurement for a system solution, this structure should enable it, whether it's for battery electrified vehicles or hydrogen fuel cell electrified vehicles in the future, or as I said, autonomous and electrified shuttle systems in the future. So that's how it's being designed. Thus, it's an intended plan. We do expect there will probably be a few delays in between as we learn how to structure it fully and deploy it fully. And of course, it's the first time such an initiative has gone into a federal funding pool for both the planning processes and also the capital procurement processes. So with that, what we're going to do is we've got about 5 minutes for a roundtable of feedback before we close out. And I'm just going to turn to folks on the line to see if there are any questions. And Soumya, I'll just ask you to go back to the roll call slide and we'll put the folks up on the line who are attending with us today. If you do have a question and you are online today, you're more than welcome to position your question here in the Q&A function. You can also raise your hand and then we're aware that you have a query, or you can put it in a direct chat and we'll check it. And as I noted, these are all the folks that are joining us online here today. And so if you do come from any of these entities, feel free to pose a question with us and we'll answer it live just now. If you need some time to absorb, not a problem. Please absorb it. And what I'll ask you to do, Soumya, if you don't mind going right back to where you were at the end of the presentation, we're going to just put up Jessica's contact details. And so for those of you who need a bit of time to think about it internally and come back to us with a question, there we have Jessica Hansen's contact details. We do ask that you email Jessica, and ideally if you can cite the project number there in the subject line of your email, that will help her to redesign and allocate her responses specific to this project initiative. So not seeing any questions at the moment, I'll just ask you, Soumya, if you wouldn't mind going back to the conference, and it gives folks a minute or two just to absorb. We're going to highlight two elements. One is that this will also be discussed at our Low Carbon Smart Mobility Conference and our Smart Rail Technology Conference. The Low Carbon Smart Mobility Conference on the left-hand side is the conference actually that is referring to zero emissions transit. So we have the tagline there for the rail conference, which is on track to a net zero future. But the tagline for the Low Carbon Smart Mobility Conference is actually en route to a net zero future. So for those of you who aren't aware, November 28th, 29th and 30th is all zero emissions bus, hydrogen fuel cell, electric bus, all things about transit decarbonization. And that's happening in Scarborough. We will have panels and sessions dedicated to joint procurement initiatives and to this one, as well as TTC and ATUC, and making sure that everybody at that conference has all the knowledge they need about every joint procurement happening in the country. And then we, of course, have the Smart Rail Conference, not as applicable to this audience here today, but it follows at the same location the following 2 days. And there's a lot of discussion there about hydrogen rail and battery electric rail. To the extent that it overlaps with your LRT or rail systems, there are panels and sessions around electric bus integration with your rail station stops. So that will be of value too. If you're at one conference, you may want to stay for the second one. Jess has just dropped the link in the right-hand side for you to register. If you go forward one more slide, for those of you who are a little bit newer to CUTRIC or you just missed the email, we did release our Canadian ZEB database report earlier this year. The first report went out the door. If you are a member, you can download the report for free. So there's the QR code, and there's also the link Jess has just plunked in there. You can download it. If you're having any trouble downloading it, but you are a member agency, feel free to reach out to Jessica again or any one of our staff. We'll make sure you get the member code so that you can download it openly. If you represent a non-member company or non-member agency, then there is a fee for our reports, which helps us to offset the cost of actually doing the research. This report was issued a couple months ago. There is an updated version coming out for our members and the wider world this fall. Same thing holds. As members, you'll be able to download it for free. Non-members, there's a fee associated with it. And basically, it tells you a status report: how many battery electric buses are on the road, who owns them, exactly where are they, how many chargers are on the road, who owns them, where are they, what kind of types are they, how many fuel cell buses are on the road or in procurement, where are they, who owns them, et cetera, et cetera. And over time, over the next year, we'll be refining it even further to include things like where's the hydrogen coming from and where's the electricity coming from. So with that, Jessica has just put the contact information there for Jessica Hansen to get in contact with for either the ZEB database or for the conference. So with that, we can go to the final slide once more. And I don't see any questions, so hopefully that was very clear to everybody. And we do have a lot of participants on the line. So if you do have any more queries, I don't see any Q&A. We don't see any comments here. So we're going to assume all is crystal clear. This is recorded. We'll be sending it out on our YouTube channel. We'll make sure that folks who have registered will get copies of the PowerPoint and the presentation here today. And you are more than welcome to follow up with us post factum once you've had a chance to discuss it internally. With that, I want to thank our staff for putting together this overview today. And certainly I want to thank Sue and Kelly for supporting this as the first round of joint procurement clients. And Chris and Blair, thank you for representing the inaugural board of directors. And with that, we're off to the races with Canada's first national joint procurement initiative nationwide. So thank you once again for your time. And thank you, Salmi and Jessica, for helping us to lead this into a bright future for Canada's decarbonized transit industry. Thank you, everyone, and have a wonderful day.
Thank you.